can go.
Okay.
All right, cool.
So I'm starting from the same like lab topology, and today also we are going to cover the remaining parts. So in the previous lab session, what we covered only dynamic IP and port, NAT, and of course like a very basic security policy and interface IPs only. Interface IP with a default route and default route pointing to the next hop router, that is 192.168.0.1. So in the last session, we started from like creating first like the zones and then configuring interfaces, IP and all that, and then static route, default route, I mean, and
Yeah.
security policy just to allow services. Even we haven't talked about the applications. And then after we ended up with a creating a dynamic IP and port standard NAT policy. So today I'm going to start with first dynamic IP, another NAT, and then a static IP, of course, source NAT also again. And then we will do another lab, in fact, and based on the same NAT, in fact, and then we will introduce the third interface then. Third interface, I mean, like the DMG. So now, once like we have completed both dynamic IP and static IP NAT, then I will add another interface to the firewall and one web server like a standard web server running on port 80, and I will also connect one computer in the same DMG zone. And so first, like we will configure simply a dynamic NAT sort of thing. Like we will not introduce this machine dynamic NAT, or sorry, destination NAT, I'm sorry, destination NAT to allow access of this web server with any other IP, maybe 21 or any other IP address. And then the next scenario will be like the U-turn NAT sort of thing. So that's the lab objective. And but first thing first, so first, like we are going to start with the remaining part of the lab one, and then I will introduce the new topology. And in new topology, a third interface, that is DMG, a web server, and then first I will start with destination NAT and then U-turn NAT, like accessing web server from the same zone, that is DMG zone. And then the theory, once like we have ended up with all this, so at least we would be able to complete up to module 6, and then app ID something, the new topic. And so of course, like theory is important before just going for the lab session. So next one will be the app ID. And that is why in this security policy, if you remember, so we just included only services, like we haven't talked about the application. So that means very straightforward. DNS is allowed, all HTTP and HTTPS based applications are allowed. But once we discuss like application, then definitely we will allow or not allow, like, I mean, like we will control applications rather than controlling like our services, in fact, because services means like very much similar to the legacy firewalls, traditional firewalls. So we will then control like applications with that. But since the lab objective is not to understand like differences between application and services, lab objective is to complete NAT. And then like in the next section, application ID section, I will talk about application and services in detail, in fact, and then we'll do the lab of that. So there is one NAT policy, if you remember, then the same like topology, the same device I'm using. And so if you remember, then we created a NAT policy like inside zone, source address 10.1.1.0, source zone inside, destination zone outside, and destination address any destination address. So four, like source zone, source address, and destination zone as the matching criteria in original packet section, and then translated packet. So in translated packet, dynamic IP and port, interface address, and IP address. And I haven't talked about like the
Can
these
you
two.
go back to the translate packet?
Okay,
Go to
sure.
the NAT translate packet right here. The last one here. Okay, I have a question here.
Yes.
You are trying to basically pretty much you are using a PAT, outbound overload, right? Sounds to
Yes,
me.
correct, correct.
If you are overloading to the interface with the IP of 192.168.0.20, right? What is the difference between that and if I change the mask into /32?
Okay, so basically, Flash 32 is like, of course, first, like the mask assigned to the interface is slash 24 first. And in production network, however, like in real environment, most of the time the interface, like the wire interface, internet interface, assigned slash 30 mask usually. But basically, I haven't configured here like the IP address. So the moment you select like the interface here, then IP address automatically is like it is like there, and in fact automatically it is taken like from the interface configuration. I mean, like when we assign IP address to the Ethernet 1/2, then there we assigned mask slash 24. But yes, your question is something like why not is a slash 32? I mean, like the individual host. So definitely, if you select here like the not interface, if you select the IP address, like translated address here, and you specify the IP there, I mean like any IP address. So even if you don't say like slash 32, it's always considered as slash 32 only. I mean like the individual IP address, only one IP address. So when we select translated address, then yes, IP we specify there, and this IP address of course can be and will be different than that of the interface IP address. I mean like the interface IP address is 192.168.0.20, but here like we can use any routable address there, not necessarily the interface address at first point. Second, of course, if you do not specify subnet mask in the Palo Alto firewall anywhere, so it is always considered as slash 32, of course, slash 32. But when I select here interface that I want source IP to be translated with the firewall egress interface IP, so IP automatically appear here, like IP address. I haven't specified that and from where. So it is from this network configuration tab. In fact, I mean like when we assigned IP to Ethernet 1/2, so there we assigned slash 24. If you remember then, we yes. assign slash 24. So from here only it is using the IP address. I mean, so your question is yes, valid point, but yes, if we are going to use any other IP address for the NAT except this interface IP, so definitely the mask will be of course slash 32. Slash 32 means like individual IP address. So that's correct.
Yep. Okay. Understand now. Yeah.
Okay. So I'm back to this NAT policy. All right. And here is the source NAT. And another point, let me show you first. In the original package section, if you look at the different options there, so source zone, source address, very much like the destination zone and destination address. I haven't talked about the destination interface and service here. There are six criteria there in the original packet, like matching packet section. Source zone, source address, destination zone, destination address, plus destination interface and the service. Service, of course, service is very rarely it is used and not required. By why? Because we control like what application or service should be allowed and what application or service should not be allowed with very much with the security policy. So even if I have said here like service any, it not necessarily means that all services will be allowed. No. Of course, what service or services will be allowed, controlled with the security policy. So it's of course not very much relevant here, but destination interface, yes, can be relevant and when. So let me, before I just go to the lab station, let me make another point here. So let's say your scenario is something like Palo Alto firewall, and there are two ISP link, ISP1 internet link. And ISP2 to connect to internet cloud, internet here. Okay, and LAN side here, Ethernet 1/2, Ethernet 1/3, they both can be in the same zone or maybe in different zone, no problem whatsoever, zone wise, no problem. And Ethernet 1/1 is my inside. So maybe like both interfaces can be in the same zone, no problem whatsoever. And Ethernet 1/1 in one zone. So now here, the point here is like, let's say I want to configure policy-based forwarding, or in Cisco world, it is known as PBR, right? Are you aware of it? PBR?
Yeah, policy-based routing.
Correct. That's correct. Policy-based routing. And we do with the route map in the Cisco routers, right?
Yes. Yeah. Match. And then we forward to next hop gateway.
Yes. And same here, like in Palo Alto Firewall, we have similar kind of like configuration here, but known as PBF, policy-based forwarding instead of PBR. So what we do, we configure here like a policy-based routing. That is, let's say the policy-based routing is something like policy-based forwarding. I mean, in Palo Alto, it is known as policy-based forwarding. So let's say my policy is similar to this, that if let's say for certain applications or services, a whole bunch of services, let's say use Ethernet ISP one link. I mean, the routing is like this, ISP one. So let's say the services are like HTTP or maybe HTTPS or DNS, ISP one. For other services, let's say Telnet, SSH, or some other application, use ISP two. So yes, it is very much configurable in Palo Alto because already like in introduction section, I discussed this point that Palo Alto firewall is very much like a network device, in fact, a network firewall, and almost like the similar like routing capability as there is in the Cisco router. So I mean like configuring BGP, OSP, policy-based forwarding, multicast routing is all there. So if we configure policy-based forwarding and the policy is like this one, use ISP1 for HTTP, HTTPS DNS, and ISP2 for Telnet and SSS, right? Understood? So this is what PBF. Now the point is here is, and the NAT, source NAT, I want to use like the source NAT dynamic IP and port to translate with the interface IP. So now if from the PBF, policy-based forwarding, let's say Ethernet 1/2 is like used as the egress interface. So definitely in source NAT, Ethernet 1/2 IP should be used. And if from the routing, Ethernet 1/3 becomes egress interface, then in the same source NAT policy, Ethernet 1/3 interface should be used as the source IP. It means now we want to bring interface also. I mean, the condition is like this. If source is this network, source zone inside, destination is, let's say, any destination zone outside. So it is common for both, like, I mean, like whether ISP1 or ISP2. Now, if the interface, egress interface, is Ethernet 1/2, then translate with Ethernet 1/2 interface IP. And if interface is Ethernet 1/3, then translate with Ethernet 1/3 interface IP. It means if there are two interfaces, like our external interfaces, and we also want to include interface there in the policy. I mean this one, source zone inside, destination zone outside, source address this one, destination address any, and if the interface is Ethernet 1/2, then I'll go there, I'll select Ethernet 1/2 IP. And if like Ethernet is like, let's say interface, like let's say like here, like there has been like the third interface Ethernet 1/3, so we are matching with the egress interface also. With policy based forwarding, if the egress interface has been chosen Ethernet 1/3, then in NATing, use Ethernet 1/3 IP. And if in the routing, Ethernet 1/2 has been picked up as the egress interface, then translate with Ethernet 1/2 interface IP. So in this way, like policy is very simple in Palo Alto firewall. And there, like we use this destination interface. But in this topology, like what that I am using here, only one interface there and no policy-based forwarding, because I haven't talked about the routing up until, in fact, I will talk about routing in Palo Alto firewall later on, but we haven't touched that part, routing part in the Palo Alto firewall. So that is why I'm not going to use like destination interface there. And you understand, like in NATing, in Palo Alto firewall, really is very straightforward, because in some other firewalls or maybe appliances, even in SD-WAN or somewhere, like if there is NAT policy and we want that if source is A and destination is B, then there should be NAT. If the source address is A and destination is something different, then do not do NAT. So for that, what we do, we create a NAT exempt policy or rule sort of thing. When to do NAT, when not to do NAT, and especially in the VPN, IPsec VPN. Because in IPsec VPN tunnel, we do not allow NAT to happen. And over the internet, yes, NAT should be allowed. So there, like when we configure VPN and all that, so really it becomes very important to just, you know, like fine tune your NAT policy and NAT rule there. In Palo Alto, no, it's not required. Why? Because there are multiple matching criteria. Because when we use VPN, so we create a separate zone for that. So packet will never match with this NAT policy, because all four, source and destination zone, source and destination address, if they all four parameters, attributes are matching up, then only NAT will happen. So that is why in Palo Alto, NATing is not very complex. If you understand the packet flow and the way how we create the NAT policy rule, it's really very simple. In other firewalls, maybe can be a bit tricky, because in Palo Alto, we are matching with different parameters or attributes. That is why. So, but in VPN, I will talk about this concept in detail. Why, like in some other firewalls, NAT sometimes becomes tricky, in fact. And when we would have to create NAT exempt or NAT exemption, I mean, like not to do NAT policy sort of thing. When and in what scenario? In Palo Alto, of course, not required, but I will discuss in VPS itself.
Wait, hold on. When you said, wait a second. Okay, so let me understand this. Your source are the same, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Your source are the same. And then yeah. It depends on the services or applications where you're trying to forward to different ISP gateways.
Yes, correct? Yes. We can include service in that way also. But still, mm-hmm. let's say here, like you have specified that if the service is HTTP, then do the NAT. And in the security policy, if HTTP is not allowed, so even with the NAT policy is okay. NAT, I mean, like with the NAT policy, definitely the IP or source IP should be translated. But since if the security policy doesn't allow that service, so of course, flow will never be successful. I mean, like the traffic will not be allowed, of course. It means not only service is specified here plays important role, service in the security policy is also important. But yes, if you want to use service in that way, as you said, definitely you can do that. You can include service also, that if the source is matching up or destination is matching up, source and destination zone also, service also, then do the NAT. Yes, you can use that way also.
Right, but the questions you create, because when you for out, depends on you obviously in NATing, using the two different interfaces. One, you go to ISP1, let's say mm-hmm. using mm-hmm. E1x2, right? When you go to mm-hmm. ISP2, you're using E1x3. However, when you NAT it, then when you NAT the source IP, when you try to hide the source, mm-hmm. right? Hide that, are you hiding to different NATing IP?
Yes. Correct? Yes, correct. Correct.
Right. So when you're hiding the different NAT IP, in other words, when you go to the destination will look at it, it's a two different path, right? Because destination, when the return path is coming back, right? The source will be from ISP, whatever the somewhere up there, that's where the source, from somewhere in the internet or cloud, right? Mm-hmm. And then coming back, when you see the NAT IP, from that NAT IP is the destination coming back to the firewall.
Hmm. So of course, like if Palo Alto firewall is like doing like sometime like maybe for one service source IP is translated with mention any IP here 1.1.1 for example, and mm-hmm. here is like 2.2.2. Right. So maybe for one application the source IP translated with 1.1.1. Maybe for another application source IP translated with 2.2.2. So even for return traffic, there will not be any problem, because if like the IPs are public IPs, so public IPs will be advertised by the corresponding service provider only. So definitely the routing will, I mean, like the reply packet will take the same path. I mean, there will not be any asymmetric routing there.
Correct. When are you using, like you said, non-net, no net, you know, in the firewall provision, I think the Cisco ASA is a net zero policy, which is no translation.
Mm-hmm.
When are you using that in this epic like this, in the Palo?
Okay, so in Palo Alto, not required that kind of policy is not required, like the net zero sort of thing. And why it is, like, very quickly, let me take this example. So let's say in Palo Alto firewall, or let's say here, like there is one Palo Alto firewall, LAN side network, and of course, like internet here or something. Let's say PA1 and PA2 there.
Oh,
and LAN 2 and LAN 1 here. LAN 1 is, let's say, LAN side network is 10.0.0.1, mm-hmm. and here my private network is 172.16.0.0/16. They are also connected to the internet, of course, and there is also IPsec tunnel created between them.
Is IPsec VPN?
IPsec VPN. Yes. So definitely, no, you understand. So not what we want that if any traffic sourcing from LAN 1 and destined to LAN 2, then there should be no NAT, right?
Correct. Yeah, I got it. Yeah, now I know. Yeah.
And the source IP is same LAN 1, but the destination is internet, then do the NAT.
Then NAT.
Here, like in Palo Alto firewall, it's not a problem there in Palo Alto firewall. Why it is not problem in Palo Alto firewall and no need to create NAT zero sort of thing? Because in Palo Alto firewall, when we create NAT policy, then we also specify the zone. So basically, when we create IPsec tunnel, so we put the tunnel interface in a separate zone. Let's say the zone name is VPN zone, and this interface that actually connects to internet is in outside zone, right? Outside zone or internet zone. From here it is, you know, like, so no need to create no NAT sort of thing, because in NAT policy, what we are saying, source inside zone, destination outside zone, do the NAT. So understood. Yes. If the source is inside and destination is VPN zone, so automatically NAT will never be done, right?
So here,
Palo Alto firewall is very simple. Like, so we that is why we never compare with the ASA or any other firewall, because they're like, we create, like, if this is the source destination, do not, don't do that kind of thing.
Yes.
Here we don't do that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Because it's a zone base. I see now.
So it's all about like the matching criteria here. So whole bunch of matching options there, source zone, destination zone, source address, destination address, and even required then egress interface and also service over the both are not mandatory, but we can match with like interface and service also. Okay. So now I'm back to the lab topology, and the lab is like, first, like, very quickly, will take not more than 5 to 10 minutes. So very quickly, we want to see like the this one, dynamic IP. And let's do some check there, like is running or not, what is the status for now? Is there any traffic passing through? Yes. So still it is the same, like the dynamic IP endpoint. Source IP address 10.1.50, source port, and inside zone, protocol number 6, like for the TCP, and is translating to this IP, firewall interface IP, and the port also 304333. Yep. So it means the source IP translated to this IP, and source port is also translated, right?
Yes.
And that's what dynamic IP and port is, like translating both source IP and source port. Now, very quickly, I'm going to create another, the same policy. I'm going to make a small change there. And the change is like, now this time I do not want to translate source IP with the firewall egress interface IP. Rather, I'm going to use the NAT IP, virtual IP address, right? Yep. I'm going to use virtual IP address this time. And so that the port should remain preserved, untranslated, unchanged. I mean, like, I do not want this port to be translated. What I want, my requirement is port should remain preserved. I mean, like, exactly, unchanged, in fact. Yes, correct. So, a very small change there, and the source translated packet. So, this time, now, I'm not going to use dynamic IP and port option. Now, I will select dynamic IP, and then here, like, we have the option to specify the IP. So, let's say I say 192.168.0. Let's say 40 to maybe 192.168.0.45 or something, right?
Yeah.
Whole like 5 or 6 IPs there, and simple, okay. And commit the changes. So like this time, like we like are going to translate source IP with the NAT IP, that is virtual IP, not the real IP, not the real IP. Not assigned to any interface, in fact. And routing wise, we don't need to worry in production network also, because like the routing part, ISP will take care of that. The service provider, like the service provider, like who has just given the public IPs, will take care of routing. So we don't need to be bothered with the routing part, in fact. So whatever public IP pool we have, we can use there in the NAT policy. So now here, like I'm going to initiate traffic from this machine, like the computer behind the firewall, this one, Windows 10 computer, like 10.1.1.50, it is in LAN side. So I'm going to initiate traffic from there. So very quickly, okay. So already I have accessed this virtual machine, 10.1.1.50, open browser, and initiate any traffic, because already we have allowed all HTTP and HTTPS application. All HTTP and HTTPS applications are allowed. So of course, like we can initiate traffic to any destination, no problem, because we haven't like specified any application there. So Cisco, it is running, F5.com should be running, of course. Any other site, let's say LinkedIn.com or something. So should be also working. So I'm in India, so automatically it is directed. So it's all working, like F5, Cisco, LinkedIn, and of course, definitely this should work. So now, so it's all working there, and remote desktop connection, minimize this, and I'm back to my CLI, and this time, social and I can use a filter to filter a specific application. And let's say the application I'm looking for LinkedIn base only. Okay, so here we go. What should not be source IP there? 10.1.1.50 translated to 40 IP, this one. And what about the port number? So I'm curious about the port, and port number, yes, it is same, not translated. And that's the only benefit in dynamic IP. And now here there is one question, and the question is like, what if all IPs is specified there? I mean, like in the pool, there total 40 to 45 IPs. Now, if all IPs are in use, exhausted, no available IP there, let's say a very large enterprise network, like thousands of computers on the LAN side, of course, 1,000 private IPs, I mean, public IPs, hardly there are 5 or 6 IPs here. So it's many translation. So what if all IPs are in use, exhausted this pool, and a new connection, like, arrives there on the firewall, so definitely will get dropped, right? Because there is no available IP address. And when this situation may occur in the production network in long-lived connection, basically, HTTP means very short-lived connection, very temporary connection, in fact, very short-lived connection. So whenever we open any page, then like too many connections are created, and immediately they all are like terminated also. I mean, like very short-lived connections. They don't be there in the table for very long time. No. But what about FTP or any other protocol? Let's say users are downloading some software or program by using the FTP from any external source. So FTP connections means long-lived connections. Let's say like a lot of users are downloading some software, maybe 5 GB, 10 GB. So yes, IPs, they all will be used in the NAT translation. So Palo Alto provides a fallback mechanism then. And what is that? So when you configure dynamic IP, so it is optional, but recommended that just click there, advanced dynamic IP and port fallback. And then basically what we are doing, we are enabling also dynamic IP and port translation, but only as a fallback. It means first preference will be given to dynamic IP, but in case if there is no available IP address in the dynamic IP NAT pool, then finally a last resort will be dynamic IP and port. So at least connection will be allowed. Of course, port will get translated now this time. So port will not cannot be preserved in dynamic IP and port, but at least there will be internet access, even though port will be changed. Of course, port will not remain same, because in dynamic IP and port, we know that both source IP and source port address both get translated there. But at least you can go with this option.
Right. So the question is, when you assign, okay, when you first create this net pool, right, from 40.45, you create a 6 IP address. So so pretty much you are designated your IP address from your source, take the first 6 IP, right? After you exhaust it, okay, the number 7 IP come in there. When the number 7 come in, you are using the fallback, which is advanced dynamic IP with the port numbers to solve this issue. I understand that. But the number 7 IP, when they net it, what is the first IP? Are you using .40 or using a randomly pick between 40 to 46?
First thing, like in dynamic IP and port or dynamic IP, what is happening here? Let's say it's my Palo Alto firewall. Mm-hmm. First computer request arrives on the firewall. Right, so maybe a Palo Alto firewall is going to use the first IP address. Maybe,
right, but 40 can, to, okay.
40, maybe can be any IP address. Even like we don't have any control over that because it's all dynamic. So we don't have control, but let us assume that Palo Alto firewall has used 40 to translate. Maybe another request then 41. In the meantime, if reply packet comes back of the first flow, so this IP address will be again available in the pool because it is not dedicated. Correct. So maybe another computer, so again 40 will be assigned to that machine also because it's all dynamic. So we never know, any available IP address can be used for any connection, of course. And the IP, of course, is not available till the time there is no reply packet coming back, or maybe till the time timed out has not expired. I mean, IP is free, in fact, very soon, right? Once the connection is completed, maybe sitting computer is sitting idle, opening up a new session or something. So the IP is released now, IP is free, so IP can be used. But the scenario that I discussed was something if all 6 IPs are not free, not released, I mean, there are six computers total, and they all are using FTP connection, long lived connections, right? Correct. So IP is not available there. Then I have configured this dynamic IP and port. So in dynamic IP and port, I will use firewall egress interface IP, in fact, not this IP 40 to 45. No, already they are exhausted. The pool is exhausted there. So in dynamic IP and port, I will select my egress interface. That if a new connection is coming, then please translate with the firewall interface IP, right?
Got it. I understand. I thought you were using, I thought the fallback was using the pool's IP with a dynamic port.
No. Already pool IP, no available pool IP, all exhausted there. So basically, and let me show you that. So if I go there, advanced this one, dynamic IP and port, and I select interface address, and interface is Ethernet 1/2, yes, and then the IP is this one. Here is 20.
That's the config I was looking for, because I thought it was pool's IP with the dynamic port number engine.
No, it's not like that. Or, and another important point, in some firewalls, in NAT rule, or NAT policy, or NAT rule, in fact, there is some predefined preference. I mean, like that a static NAT will be preferred over dynamic NAT or something kind of thing. But in Palo Alto firewall, as so there is no preference like a static NAT is preferred over dynamic or dynamic preferred over static. No, in Palo Alto firewall, NAT rules are also checked from top to bottom. So it's all about the sequence only, like where you have put the NAT rule there, sequence number 1, 2, 3, 4, that is important here. So as such, here, like there is nothing like that one NAT rule supersedes another or override another one. No, it's not like that, in fact, in Palo Alto firewall. So it's all about the sequencing. It means whenever you are creating NAT policy, also you have to take precaution at the about the order sequence, which NAT rule should be at the top, which NAT rule should be at the bottom. You have to decide that in very precisely, in fact, because as there is no preference of one NAT over another. It's all about the rule number, NAT rule number, because it is examined, evaluated, processed top to bottom. So that's another important point to note down here and is committed now. Okay, and the third NAT here is in the source NAT also is like in the same, like this time, let's say I want to go with the static NAT. So in static NAT, the one-to-one static IP. Technically here it is known as static IP. So first thing, if I directly go there in the translated packet section, and if I select the static IP and I said, please translate source IP address with, let's say 39, for example, 39 is the IP address, right? Mm-hmm. But there is one mistake with this policy. And let me show you that mistake there. Okay, I hit down the okay. Now I'm going to commit. Rule is not correct. NAT policy is not correct. There is one mistake there. But let me show you the error message, like what error message is come. Because I'm expecting an error message here. Definitely should not be committed. In fact, the policy should not be committed. So I'm expecting an error message here because there is some issue with the NAT rule. And here there is a problem here. And the problem is what? Mismatch. NAT rule mismatch of static IP source translation address range between original address and translated packet. So what it is telling us that there is some issue in the original packet section. And yes, and what is the issue? So as we know, static NAT is one-to-one mapping. And what is this?
You pick a range.
Yes, correct. That is right. So one-to-one means like there has to be only one IP. And now here /32 concept comes into picture. /32 means individual IP address. So now if
you need a host IP in there.
Exactly. And this topology, the host IP is 10.1.1.50. 10.1.1.50. So I need to match with 10.1.1.50. And even if you do not specify /32, it is by default /32, right? So if you specify IP without mask in Palo Alto firewall, it is always considered to be /32, right? So good. And before I just again go to the comment, and here I will set enable bidirectional there, right? So I'll do that in the next time. But for now, there is no bidirectional here, no bidirectional option.
It's enabled. One way.
Exactly, correct. It's a one way. Only the request packet should be originated from inside zone to outside zone only. It's a one way. No, outside to inside. And I will show you that also. And here, there is no option to do the port forwarding or port translation sort of thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
It means if you want the port translation or port forwarding, it is not there in the static IP. It means only IP to IP mapping, yes, can be unidirectional, can be bidirectional, but only IP to IP mapping. Can be uni or bidirectional, but only IP to IP mapping. And for example, in this diagram, if let this be committed first. So let's say here in this diagram, my web server is running on port 8080. For example, the TCP port 8080, and external requests are hitting on port 80. So what I want? I want both IP and port number, they both to be translated. So this kind of thing is not possible with the static NAT in Palo Alto firewall, at least. It means static PAT is not there in Palo Alto firewall. So for that, the only option is configuring destination NAT. Another difference, as we discussed in the theory class, in destination NAT, there is no bi-directional option there. It means only one way, this way only. A static NAT, there is option to enable bi-directional. But in a static NAT, no option to do the port forwarding or port translation. But in destination NAT, yes, we can do that. If required, then we can do that also.
Can you, hold on. Can you go back to the previous diagram? I'm sorry, leave it here. So question, if I create a static NAT and I enable a bi-directional, okay. Would that resolve this issue instead of using that destination NAT policy? If I create a static NAT one-to-one and then I enable a bi-directional now, for the web server where I want to reach it, when I want to reach the web server, would I do it?
Okay, yes, you can do that. I mean, like if you create a static NAT this way, I mean like from the DMZ to outside and you enable bi-directional, then yes, another rule is created and yes, will be resolved. But there is one issue. Issue is what? The moment we enable bi-directional, so what happens? For example, here, the rule that I created was like source zone inside, destination zone outside, source address this one, and destination this IP, not this one. Source IP, this IP, 10.1.1.50. And then we mapped with some IP like 39 or something. And if I enable like bi-directional, so technically what's happening there in the Palo Alto firewall, another rule, another NAT policy is automatically created, right? Because I have created rule in one direction, inside to outside. And if you enable bi-directional option, that means another NAT
that's
policy is
going to inside.
Exactly, another NAT policy is created. And this NAT policy, automatically created NAT policy will be similar to destination NAT policy. Similar to destination NAT policy, right?
Right, but it's from outside to inside.
Outside to inside. But as we discussed in the like theory, that when we create destination NAT policy in general, so like the source zone that we take is outside.
Yeah.
And destination zone also we take outside.
Outside.
Correct?
Yeah.
And why? Because the NAT IP is always be resting in there only. That is why. So now the question is, if pay attention to the statement that I'm going to like say here, if I create a static NAT policy from inside to outside and enable bi-directional, so as we know, automatically another NAT policy will be created for in reverse direction, but automatically created NAT policy will not be exactly identical to this one, in fact. So basically, the zone there will be any sort of thing. And I'm going to show you that. It means, yes, when we enable bi-directional option, then automatically another NAT policy is created in reverse direction, but that is not identical to the destination NAT policy that we create, because we specify outside to outside. We're not saying like any sort of thing.
Outside to inside.
Right? We're not saying any to outside or outside to any. No, we're not saying like that. But here, like, when the automatically NAT policy is created, then the zone it takes like as the source zone is like any sort of thing, and I'm going to show you that. So hold on, just let me finish with this first, and then I'm just going to enable bi-directional also. But before that, as there is no bi-directional here, so let's do the verification, very quick verification of this first, and then I'm going to enable bi-directional also, and then I will show you the automatically created NAT policy, like if we enable bi-directional. But yes, your question was like, can we do that way? I mean, like we create a static NAT policy this way, enable bi-directional. So whether this server will be accessible from outside, answer is yes. Of course, like it's not very secure because communication can be in both the direction. Even server can also initiate the traffic. And of course, like since it is automatically generated bi-directional policy. So in future, let's say we want any kind of customization there. I mean, like we want that the port redirection, port forwarding sort of thing. So of course we cannot do all that. So that's something, the limitation. For example, let's say you have only one public IP address and here like there are two servers, one FTP server, another HTTP server. You want to use the same IP. same IP. Of course, one is for different service port, another server may be different service port. The problem is what you have only one static public IP address, but you want you want that both servers should be accessible from the internet side. So can we do with static NAT? No. Why? Because in static NAT, we cannot take services or service ports. That is why. It means it's purely one-to-one, purely one-to-one, at least in Palo Alto. It is purely one-to-one only. So it means if there are two servers, so yes, with bidirectional option, you can facilitate that both servers will be accessible from the internet, but only if you have two public IPs, right?
Yep.
One IP is statically mapped, but in production network, what happens sometimes, a crisis of or unavailability of IPv4 address there. Maybe your organization has only one static IP address, and the challenge is what? You have two servers in the DMZ, and your requirement is something like with the same IP, both servers should be accessible. So we can do that with the destination that we can include port also. So customization wise, you have more options in destination NAT as compared to static NAT. Static NAT is very much like one-to-one mapping, and I'm going to show that. Right? Makes sense? Okay. I'm back to this computer, and very quickly, let's say initiation there. So it's the old one, and let me initiate some traffic there. So I'm back to this computer, 10.1.1.50. Open any website, let's say Facebook. So I've been working. Yes, working there. And now I'm back to this. And filter, application, Facebook, base. And the IPs would have been 39, and yes, it is 39. So 10.1.1.50 translated with 39. Port translated, no. Source IP, source port, right? And source IP only translated to 39. 39 is what? Static IP, okay. Now, if I enable destination, bi-directional, right? Here, this one, okay? Let this be completed. Where it has, hold on, just let me refresh the page, like my antivirus, in fact, sometimes causes some problems. So let me very quickly log in here. So you understand like what I want to do now, right? I want to enable bidirectional option. Remind me later. I'm here. Translated packet, bidirectional. Okay. And commit this. Let this be completed. Commit. And then I will show you the NAT policy automatically created there. Almost done. Okay. Close. So now you can see this, right? Bidirectional, yes, option. Derek? Are there?
Hello?
Yes. Now I can see this. Yeah. Okay, so you can see this bidirectional, yes. Now, where is the another NAT policy rule? Policy number one, I have created. Where is policy number two? You will not find this here, right? In the GUI page. In graphical user interface page, configuration page, as such, there is not another NAT policy there. This would have been like another policy, right? In reverse direction.
Yeah.
But not there. Now, can we find the NAT policy automatically created in, like here, If I run the command, show running configuration NAT policy, right? Command, show running configuration NAT policy, and look at the output here. I run the command, this one, show running config NAT policy is the command. And now if you can, of course, you can look at this. Source NAT static IP index number one. Index number one, like the rule that we created. And yep. let me scroll to index number two here. So this rule number two, not created by me, automatically created, right?
Right.
And the rule here is like source any. Oh, that's what I was discussing at that point. Source any and destination outside zone. It means automatically created NAT policy is something like automatically created NAT policy is source zone
is any.
Exactly. And destination zone is outside. If we create destination NAT zone, then we don't take source any. In fact, what we take? We take source outside.
Yes.
Very specific, right? Because we know the traffic is coming from outside only, not any sort of thing. Yeah. So in large, where you have large number of NAT policy and rules, so maybe this may create problems sort of thing. So usually we avoid enabling bidirectional on the static NAT, but yes, if required, then do that. But better, best option is creating a destination NAT policy, or if we enable bidirectional, then automatically a NAT rule is created, but then automatically NAT rule created there is similar to this. Source any and destination outside, and rest good, no problem. But source is not outside sort of thing. So I'm going to create, I hope you understand this point.
Yeah. So you need to be very detailed on this.
Okay. Okay. So bidirectional and Okay. Now let me delete all this policy, not required anyway. Let me discuss another scenario here. This one. Now, requirement is my requirement objective is very simple. Even the policy can be there, no problem. No need to delete that. Something inside to outside. But here, this time, my requirement is objective is what? This web server, there is a web server connected to the DMZ network segment. And this web server should be accessible from internet side, from anywhere, from here maybe.
Okay.
But not with the same IP. Maybe this IP 21 is the IP address that I want to use, the NAT IP. Interface IP is 20. So definitely I need to create a destination NAT policy, right?
Yeah.
But for that, first let me configure Ethernet 1/3 interface and put that interface in a separate zone, that is DMZ zone. So very quickly, I'm going to configure the third interface here, Ethernet 1/3. And Ethernet 1/3 interface should be in a separate zone, and the zone is here DMZ zone. So if there is no DMZ zone there, so I will create one. So of course no DMZ zone, because on that day we created only two zone, if you remember. Then the third one, I'm going to create DMZ and okay. And the IP address here 172.16.0.20/16 with the default mask I want to go with. Okay, then interface configured. Now, I'm going to create a destination NAT policy, and help me here in writing down the NAT policy, destination NAT policy. And let me also open this diagram, in fact, so that you can link with this destination NAT policy here. Okay. Here is the diagram.
Okay.
So what we want to write down NAT policy here, right? So what? So first, the name, let's say destination NAT policy name is very informative. Now, source zone. What I should take in the source zone outside? Okay.
Source zone. Yep. And outside, and then the destination is outside.
Okay.
Is outside.
Source address any.
Does any?
And destination address is the NAT IP, virtual IP.
168.0.21.
Correct.
Okay.
And then translated packet, and this time I'm going to select destination address, this one.
Right, so you translate it, okay.
I want to translate with the static IP, and the IP is DMZ server IP. That is 50, let me show you the diagram there. DMG server IP is 172.16.0.50.
Correct.
So here is the 50. Okay. Destination net policy created. And what about the security policy? Do I need to create a security policy?
Yes.
Yes.
From outside to outside.
Okay. So I need to create a outside to towards DMG, of course.
Right,
outside
right.
to DMG, HTTP.
Right.
HTTP okay. access. Okay. Mm-hmm. And source zone should be outside.
Outside, right.
Source address outside, any.
Source address any.
And what about the destination zone?
Destination is outside.
It's a security policy, Derek.
Oh, the security policy. So from that, you net it in security policy. So wait, from that, where are you?
So security policy. So source zone is outside that, correct?
Outside, yep.
Source address any, that is correct. Destination
right.
destination IP is this one, that is also correct. And destination
yep.
zone. So in security policy, destination zone is post
outside.
Post net zone. Post net zone. It means okay. after the net. So once like net.
Oh,
is
I'm not, sorry. Yeah, 191. Just a post net zone. That's a DMZ.
Yes, that's correct.
That's a DMZ.
Now correct. Now correct. Okay. Outside to DMZ. So in security policy. You have to take here destination zone as DMG. Destination address, of course, obvious, and 192.168.0.21. And service-wise, I want to just enable HTTP only. HTTP, incoming HTTP. Action, allowed, okay. And then finally, I'm going to commit this. So I've created a NAT policy, and also I have created a security policy, one NAT and one security policy, okay. And then how I will do the verification. So I will access this server with 21 IP address, right? 21 IP address. And this server should be then accessible, web server with this IP.
Yes.
Not with the real IP and this will like.
Yeah.
So let this be completed. Okay, almost done, close. And there in like a session table, so session all, and even if we can use a filter also with maybe the destination IP, destination.
Mm-hmm.
Destination is like 192.168.0.21, right?
Yep.
Okay. So I said no session because I haven't accessed the server, right? Now I'm going to access that. So the server IP, NAT IP is 21. So I'm accessing with the 21 IP, and here we go. So already I have created a web server there, connected there, right? And the I have done a small, like, you know, like HTML coding and all that. So the IP is like 192.168.0.50. And even we can do the same verification from this session table also. And here we go, right? And this time, Derek, just look at the flag here. Flag is now ND. N stand for NAT, right? And D stand for, yes, that's correct. So D stand for your destination. D stand for destination NAT. So this time, destination NAT. And 192.168.0.181.
That's your source?
Source IP, that's correct. Destination was 21. And 21. Destination translated to 50.
50.
That's one.
Yep, I see that.
Correct?
Yep.
Okay. And source untranslated. Like same.
Yes.
So this way, because my computer IP is 181. 181 is my IP address basically. I'm also on the outside network. So I have accessed the web server from my laptop only, and destination IP translated there.
Yes.
Now, let me bring another like interesting point here. Now, what if another computer from the same DMZ zone, this one. Now, if I want to access the server from here, client machine, this server, just a minute. I'm getting a call. So let's
okay,
just
give don't
it.
Worry. Yeah, go ahead. Yep.
Hello? Hello? Hanji? Hello. Sorry, Darren.
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah, I'm here.
Was urgent call, so I had to take that.
No worries.
Okay. So now the objective here is like accessing the web server from the computer in the same zone. I mean, like the DMZ to DMZ only, but computer, this client machine will not access the server with its real IP address. So what we want that computer in the same zone, of course, would be able to access the web server, but not with its real IP, rather, should use the same NAT IP address. It means the packet should go this way to the DM firewall, and then firewall to the web server to the firewall, and then again, firewall to the, like this, machine only this way. So first, I'm going to create a NAT policy first. And this time, you understand like what kind of NAT policy we need here? Destination NAT?
If you want to access the destination, if the destination remain the same, yes. You still need 192.168.0.21, right?
Yes, destination will remain the same. Destination will be 192.168.0.21, and destination right. zone will also be outside. So right.
You need a proxy server. You just looking for a proxy server to do it.
Yes, but the source zones would be now DMZ, right?
Right, the source will be DMZ, right?
And the destination is outside. Outside and destination, correct.
Yeah.
So let me write down that first, and then we will see like what kind of error message we are receiving there. So yes, the NAT policy add, and the NAT policy is something like DMZ to DMZ basically. DMZ yeah. to DMZ, of course, but the policy is like should be a source zone DMZ, destination zone outside, correct, and source address anyone from this network, like let's say 172.16.0.0. Even we can include like the like complete network, mm-hmm. or maybe individual IP, okay. Destination IP address would be 21, correct?
That's outside, yeah.
Outside, okay. And translated address, of course, like the static IP address.
Okay, 192.168.
Translated IP, server IP, actual IP, server IP.
I'm sorry, 172.16.0.50.
0.50, correct. So 172.16.0.50, correct. And what do you think? Security policy required or not?
Security policy. You do. You definitely do.
Because if so, I am accessing from here to here, so basically.
You're going outside, you're going out. You're not going the same zone. You're going outside right now.
But we are going to outside, but technically the packet will never be routed to outside. In fact, we'll take a U-turn from here like this.
Correct.
Right?
Correct. Yeah.
This way. Yeah. It means yeah. ultimately DMZ to DMZ.
Is it right? Correct. So DMZ to DMZ.
Okay. And as we discussed in the security policy, by default, there is one intra-zone default policy intra zone, and that allows traffic within the zone. It means if I take this default policy, intra zone default is there, and the action there is allow. Action is allow.
Allow. The info zone, yes. However, like, can you go back there? I thought you're doing the DMZ to outside. You're not doing intra zone.
No, it's DMZ to DMZ ultimately. Why? Because in security policy, we always take post NAT zone address. So this IP address, once it is successfully translated to this, so ultimately,
communication.
Exactly, the zone,
yes.
Like DMZ to DMZ to DMZ zone only then, right? Intra zone. But if you want that, intra, there should also be a security policy to control intra-zone communication. That is possible, of course. You can change the default action of default rule. You can set like that action to deny even from allow. I mean, like if you want that, yes, I want to control intra-zone communication also. Yes, you can do that. But for that, first, you will have to change the default action of intra-zone default rule. Then only. Because okay. ultimately it's there, though, of course, we'll allow that. Okay. So now let me push this policy first. And now I want to access the web server from this machine. Where? Here. This web server. But with the NAT IP, this IP.
Mm-hmm.
So now it's verification time. before that, let's check that. Yes, almost done policy. So it's getting completed, no problem. So now I want to access the DMG machine here, and let me go there where it has stuck there somewhere. Wait. Getting stuck somewhere. Okay, I'm back to this. Okay, so I'm here, like on the machine, DMG. So if you look at the IP here, so DMG zone client machine, and the IP is 172.0.51 mask, mm-hmm. and gateway to DMG interface, right? This one.
Yeah.
So this is the third computer, like the virtual machine I have access, and okay. this machine is in DMG zone, my DMG zone, right?
Yeah.
Okay, there then now, the objective is to access the web server, DMG web server, but not with this public IP, not with the real IP.
Yep.
Accessing the server with the NAT IP, that is 192.168. Correct.
Yep.
Correct. 192.168.0.21. So the page is not loading up. And do you know mm-hmm. the reason, like why?
Yeah, it just something bothered me. Again, can you go back to the diagram?
Yes. Okay.
It just something bothered me. You know, it's not right. Hold on.
Yes.
Okay. The flow. You have, hold on. The flow is 172. Let me look at the flow. The flow is 172.16.0.51 going to hit 192.168.0.21. Okay.
Correct.
That's
correct.
The destination. All right. Mm-hmm. And then when it hit the firewall, you become the source, don't change. The source is still 172.16.0.51.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Your destination become from 192.168.0.21. You flipped it, you net it into 172.16.0.50.
Okay? Absolutely right. Correct.
That's a forward direction.
Yes.
Flow. Okay.
Yes.
Let's look at the return path. Let's look at the return path.
Okay.
Now your return will be from 172.16.0.50,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
His destination address is 172.16.0.51. That's
correct.
The destination.
Correct.
And he's gonna go local zone. He's gonna ARP and hit the local. He's not gonna go to firewall path again.
Correct.
That's so your destination source, they're not matches.
Yes. So the reply packet is this way, and that is why client is not accepting that packet, right?
Exactly. Yes. This is what I work because your source destination doesn't impact the sort. There's no such a flow here.
Yes, correct. So now, and that is why the page is not loading up. So yes, your understanding is absolutely right. And can we let me see. And yes, the page not loaded up there. And let me, can we capture the packet on the Wireshark? So I have opened the Wireshark on the same machine, like the client machine, the DMG client machine. Where it is, this one. Okay, so I'm here and Ethernet 0. And I want to capture the packet for TCP port 80 only. Start capture. Saving. Okay. So, and
like you're looking for 192.
Yes, and for that, also
192.
Also, I want like hold on. So, also I want to like refresh this page so that a new request would be get generated. So, just stop this first. And too many captures there. Okay, so now I'm refreshing this. Done.
Yeah.
And stop this. So can we find like something? Starting page. So 51 is like the
right there. I
source
that
51
one.
And
it's
21.
It's the same packet.
Same. And then here there is reset, right?
Wait, hold on. Same.
And then after SYN packet, like too many retransmission, there is like acknowledgement packet, and coming from 51, 50, 52,
yep,
51.
Yeah, right? I see SYNAC. That's after translation.
SYNAC, and yeah. Immediately after second packet, my computer is sending what?
Ooh,
reset.
He's did a reset.
Reset, right? It means like now we can verify that this DMZ computer like is receiving SYNAC back from the web server, sourcing with this one, like the source address is here like 50, and 51 is my IP. There is SYNAC of the same, and immediately my computer, like the DMZ machine, is sending a reset. Sorry, I cannot accept you, right? Because that's not, I was expecting, like, I mean, like, I was, the client machine is saying that I am expecting SYNAC from this IP only, right?
Yes, he's not seeing it.
Exactly. And it is not seeing this because the SYNAC packet is coming from 51.
Yep.
Okay, cool, good. Now, how to resolve this problem now? So the objective is like to, like this machine like should be accessible, like, I mean, like this one. So how to like solve this problem? So I'm back to this Palo Alto firewall now. And now I'm going to create source NAT also to resolve this problem in the same policy, right? In the same NAT policy, not in this one, NAT policy, I'm sorry. Here is the NAT policy DMZ to DMZ. In the same DMZ to DMZ NAT policy, already I have configured to translate destination. What I'm going to do, I'm also going to configure source NAT there. And you understand, like, if source NAT is done, then yes, the flow will be successful. Why? Yeah. Because source IP address in packet number two, source and destination, they both will be translated. So source IP, this one, 51, will be translated with 20. And destination, 21, will be translated with this IP. So in this way, the flow will be symmetric. And yes, client will not have any objection with, because SYNAC will be coming from the same IP, right?
Yeah.
So now I'm going to enable dynamic IP and port, and let's do interface. Which interface? DMZ interface, right? Don't forget to select DMZ, DMZ side.
Okay, right.
20, good.
20, can you go back to the diagram?
Diagram, yes. Diagram. 20 is the
20?
Yes, yes.
Oh, okay, E13 is the 20, okay.
Okay, right?
Yeah.
So what we want that source IP address would be translated with 20.
Yep.
Okay, and then here, okay, and commit. And now we will do verification. Okay, so let this be completed. Then I'll be back to the Windows machine, like the DMZ client machine. I mean, like the machine, like here, like the machine.
Hold on, can you leave it the page? Let me just do a flow packet flow so I know what you did.
Okay. Yes.
So you did it. You also did a source net, correct?
Yes.
Yes. So now your original flow will be 172.16.0.51.
Correct.
Right? And then your destination is 192.168.0.21.
Or destination 21, correct?
21, right. And then when it hit the server, your source, your source is 172.16.0.20.
Okay, let me write down 172.0.20, correct? Correct.
Right, you did a source net, right?
Yes.
You also did a destination net. Your destination net is from 192.168.0.20. You flipped it into 172.16.0.50.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
So this is a forward traffic. Okay.
Yes.
Now look at the return path. Your return path will be your source is 172.16.0.50.
0.50, correct.
Yep. And then your destination is 172.16.0.20.
Correct.
Right. So now when he sees it is in the same LAN. He's going to get it.
Yes.
Because it's the same LAN.
Yes. And what about this packet number four then? Finally?
Your packet number four, from that, it will be, your destination is not changing. However, your source, it will go from 172.16.0.20 into 51.
Destination will be 51, correct? And source will be 192.168.0.21, right?
your source will go back. When you go back there, yes, you go back there, we will change it. Go to 192 to 168, which is original initiation.
Exactly. And that is why client will not have any problem with that. And immediately will accept the SYN ACK and then finally will send the ACK back to the web server. And in this way, the three-way handshake will be successful. And why it was not successful earlier? Because the SYN ACK packet was coming directly from the web server to the client. I mean, like the reply packet was directly coming from 172.16.0.50 instead of 192.168.0.21. And that is why like there was an like reset message there. We have seen that.
This is like a happening.
Yes. So let me first. Okay. So let me first like do the verification from there. It's committed there successfully and minimize this. I'm back to the DMG machine again one more time. And this time, even if we do the capture, capture is not required because we can do the verification from here only. So again, if I refresh the page, then yes, the page should load it up now. And here we go. So it's now accessible now. 0.21.
Can you do the shortcut section?
I will show you the table also there. So, okay. And here, by NB.
168, yep. Okay, you flip the 20. I see it, united into 20 in DMZ. Okay, and then destination is 21.
21,
yep. 50, and then
flip
DMZ,
again 50.
Then you go to 50.
Right, so source translated, destination yep. also translated.
Yes. Okay.
And the flag here is sometime this time different. N B B like by like I mean like both source and destination both.
Okay.
It's not N D.
Oh.
And
okay.
The reply packet will be flipped to this.
Right. And then your reply is 50. Oh, wait. Hold on a second. 0.20. Where is your reply section?
A reply packet, you will find like the flow in this way only because I have initiated traffic from 51 only. So in this table will show in this way, but like not another flow can be seen here, like from here. So, but if you want to find out flow-wise flow, then like the show session ID, and let's say any ID, less than 63. So it's like the client to server C2S, and S2C is like server to client, server to client. So server to client, this one like 50 to 20. And that part is not can be seen from here, from this table. So it's a bit different from like that we see in the F5 load balancer and other like the connection table. Because there what we find in fact, there in load balancer or something or any other like device connection state table, there we find two separate entries in fact there. I mean like this way. This way, first and then second. I mean like first translation and the transfer. Exactly.
Correct. It's a 2TP
section. But in firewall, like yes, you can see only one way direction. I mean like this way only. The reply packet table, like entry cannot be seen in the session table and all that. So however it is done there, and that is why the connection is getting completed. But in connection state table, it is always only one way direction. I mean, like the flow is like will be seen in one way direction. So you will not find that there. But I hope you understand the concept. Like the concept was like something translating both source and as well as destination. Right?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. So finally, we have ended up the NAT lab section, and I hope now you understand NAT in detail. Almost we have completed all the scenario that we discussed in the theory class, like source NAT, destination NAT, U-turn NAT, and accessing from the DMZ zone. So successfully we have completed all the scenarios, that we discussed in the theory session, like different types of NAT, scenario-based NAT, and we successfully covered that. And I hope you have also enjoyed this session.
I love this. Now, let me just ask you a little trivial question here.
Yes.
From your teaching experience, if this part is the most complicated?
Yes, like a lot of people think like, especially this one, like the U-turn not NAT concept. And even I have seen like people like finding it very difficult to understand or write down, especially the destination NAT policy. Even you, In remember on that day, I finished the session in 1 hour just. Usually I was expecting to finish that session in 2 or 3 hours, but even before time, like I ended up the session on that day, in the theory class, because like I have seen like people like getting confused at the time of writing down decision NAT policy. Even if I tell them just like what should be the decision zone this way. So if I ask like, now help me writing down NAT policy, if I initiate traffic from inside to DMG, then what should be the decision zone or something. So really, you know, like I always spend like an hour or so, like just to make them understand how to decide the destination zone in writing down destination NAT policy. So yes, like destination NAT is something a bit tricky here. But if anyone like who understand the bucket flow as you understand now, yes, it's very easy to write down them. And NAT, yes, like even I've seen like in interviews also, like it's very common question. I mean, like destination NAT sort of thing and the packet flow that we discussed, in destination NAT, routing table lookup is done twice, once before NAT and another routing table lookup after the NAT. So that's what like the interesting part here in the destination NAT section. And yes, like it was something like a difficult one, but we finished in very easy way, in fact, right? So you helped me also in the, a large extent, in fact. So, and that is why we ended up in very smooth way, in fact, without any complication. So credit, cool. Credit goes to you also.
Thank you. At least I know I understand something.
<cool. laughs> Okay. All right. Great. All right, Derek.
Excellent lecture. I love it. Very good.
Okay. So next class tomorrow we will start another important and exciting session, and that is application ID, app ID. So okay. We will understand tomorrow app ID, and then like the whole bunch of topics based on the content ID only, like module 8 like is content ID again, 9 is again the part of content ID, wildfire again content ID, decryption is again very important. So all 4 are like somehow related to the same concept, that is content ID. But before that, I want to finish app ID part, in fact. So tomorrow I will take the theory class of first like the app ID, and if we would be able to spare out time, then maybe we will discuss some security profiles also.
Yeah. Cool. Right? All right. Sounds good. Thank you. Nice.
Okay. All right. Okay.
All right. Thank you. You have a good day.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye. Catch you later. Okay. Bye-bye.